who are troubled in soul, who know themselves to be poor and imperfect, and who look forward to something greater to come.
Our call to worship today is from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, Jesus gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven."
You may ask, what is Advent? Well, for many Christians unfamiliar with the liturgical year, there may be some confusion surrounding the meaning of the Advent season. Some people may know that that the Advent season focuses on expectation and think that it serves as an anticipation of Christ's birth in the season leading up to Christmas. This is part of the story, but there is more to Advent.
The word Advent is derived from the Latin word adventus, meaning coming, which is a translation of the Greek word parousia. Scholars believe that during the 4th and 5th centuries in Spain and Gaul, Advent was a season of preparation for the baptism of new Christians at the January Feast of Epiphany, the celebration of God's incarnation represented by the visits of the Magi to the baby Jesus, his baptism in the Jordan River by John the Baptist, and his first miracle at Cana. During this season of preparation, Christians would spend 40 days in penance, prayer, and fasting to prepare for the celebration. Originally, there was very little connection between Advent and Christmas.
By the 6th century, however, Roman Christians had tied Advent to the coming of the Christ. But the coming they had in mind was not Christ's first coming in the manger in Bethlehem, but his second coming in the clouds as the judge of the world. It was not until the Middle Ages that the Advent season was explicitly linked to Christ's first coming in Christmas.
Advent symbolizes the present situation of the church in these last days, as God's people wait for the return of Christ in glory to consummate his eternal kingdom. The church is in a similar situation to Israel at the end of the Old Testament, in exile, waiting and hoping in prayerful expectation for the coming of the Messiah. Israel looked back to God's past gracious actions on their behalf in leading them out of Egypt in the Exodus, and on that basis they called for God once again to act for them. In the same way, the church, during Advent, looks back upon Christ's coming and celebration, while at the same time looking forward in eager anticipation to the coming of Christ's kingdom when he returns for his people. In this light, the Advent hymn, "O Come, Emmanuel," perfectly represents the church's cry during the Advent season. I would invite you in your liturgy to read with me the first line of that song, and then we'll invite Tina to come and lead us in the actual hymn. Read with me, please. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. While Israel would have sung this song in expectation of Christ's first coming, the church now sings this song in commemoration of that first coming and in expectation of the second coming in the future. Now, if you would, let's stand together and turn in your hymnals to hymn number 171.
Israel, that come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations bind, all peoples in one heart and mind. Bid envy, strife, and quarrel cease. Fill the whole world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, and death's dark shadows pull to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
To this table, we're reminded that this is the table of Jesus Christ, a banquet prepared for everyone, all who seek to be nourished and sustained in their journey of faith, all who seek wholeness and compassionate paths to peace and justice are welcome here. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift our hearts in prayer.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is good to give God thanks and praise. At this time, we remember Jesus, who on the night he died, took a loaf of bread, gave thanks to God the Father, broke it, and said, "Take and eat. Whenever you do this, remember me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant. Remember me." Jesus encourages us as believers to associate communion with his return. As we share the fruit of the vine and as we share the bread, we take it in the excited expectation that one day we will partake of communion with Jesus himself when he comes for his victorious church. Gracious God, breath of peace, source of love, we pray for your spirit. Make us, while many, one. Make us, though broken, whole. Make us, despite death, alive. And so we pray, come, Holy Spirit, come. The body of Christ, the bread of life, the lifeblood of Christ, the cup of blessing. Let us eat and drink together for our strengthening in the faith and for the sake of the world. Mitchell and I will come around and serve you, and all I ask is that you hold on to the elements and then we'll partake of them together. And as always, I ask before we take communion that you search your hearts and just ask the Lord to check and purify your heart. If you're not in a right relationship with the Lord right now, I would pray that you would resolve that before you take communion. And if you don't have a relationship with the Lord, I would suggest that communion would not be for you right now. And I would pray that you would pray for the Lord to draw you closer to himself. If you will, join with me in your liturgy and we'll read the prayer for after communion. Read with me, pray with me. We thank you, God, for breaking into our world and pouring into our lives and our experiences. We thank you, God, for this meal of thanksgiving and the stories of love, grace, and hope that it tells. Amen. All right, if you would, in Matthew 24 will be our text for the day, so if you have your Bibles with you, you may go there. And I think we'll dismiss the wee ones downstairs at this time. So specifically, our text for the day will be Matthew 24, beginning in verse 36. And we'll finish through the rest of the chapter. We'll just take a few moments to let the wee ones get situated. All right, so our text for the day is going to be Matthew chapter 4, verses 36 through 51. And the first thing we want to do is we do want to put Matthew 24 in the larger context, since we're jumping in the middle of the passage. For the Advent season, this year we're focusing on the coming again of Jesus as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who is coming for his victorious church. And to do that, we're going to be looking at Matthew 24 and 25 over the next several Sundays. And the larger context is, in Matthew 23, Jesus goes to the temple and he has a very difficult confrontation with the religious leaders. The religious leaders had become extremely corrupt, and they basically undermined everything that God wanted the temple to represent. And so Jesus goes there to declare some woes against them. As Jesus and his disciples are leaving the temple, the disciples look at the temple building and they're extremely impressed with it. It's magnificent in size, it's magnificent in wealth and riches. And they say, basically they say, Jesus, isn't this a great building? And Jesus says something very cryptic to them. He says in verse 2, do you see all these things? I tell you the truth, not one stone will be left on one another. Everyone will be thrown down. And we know that that prophecy is fulfilled about 30 years or so later. In the fall of Jerusalem, when the Romans come in, they're trying to infiltrate the temple, and they can't get in, and out of frustration, a soldier throws a torch over the wall, sets the whole temple on fire. The gold that decorates the temple melts and goes in the cracks, and the soldiers come in, and they break it down, and literally, it's just reduced to rubble, so they can get all the gold that's gone in between. And so, Jesus leaves the temple, and later the disciples ask him, and please notice they ask two questions. The first question that they ask is, when will this happen, referring to the temple? When will the temple be destroyed? And secondly, what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? So please note, the disciples are asking two separate questions, all right? So the whole chapter is not about Jesus's return, and the whole chapter is not about the destruction of the temple. It's about both. And so Jesus goes into some detail about what the destruction of the temple will look like. And I think somewhere on Facebook, we have a video where I go through that and talk about each verse and phrase as in the context of the destruction of the temple. If you get bored later, you can go back and look for it. It's very good. And I don't just say that because I did. I thought it's pretty good. Anyway, I digress. So Jesus talks to them about the destruction of the temple. And at some point, Jesus transitions to talking about what happens when he returns. And so the question is, when does that happen? Some would say that the whole chapter of 24 is about Jesus' return, which I would say maybe, but it seems that most of that fits in that earlier context of that temple destruction. But it does look like in verse 36, he transitions to exclusively talking about his return. So that's where, for the sake of the sermon, that's where we're going to transition Jesus going from temple destruction to his future return. And that's where we'll pick up in our context for the day, or our passage for the day. Matthew 24, verse 36. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill, one will be taken and the other left. Therefore keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you must also be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom the master has put in charge of the servants in his household to give them food at the proper time? It will be good for that servant whose master finds him doing so when he returns. I tell you the truth, he'll put him in charge of all his possessions. But suppose that the servant is wicked and says to himself, "My master is staying away a long time," and then he begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with drunkards. The master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he is not aware of. He will cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus begins this by talking about no one knows about that day or hour, and then he begins to talk about the Son's return. And he begins by talking about the days of Noah. And he says, in the days of Noah, everything was normal. People ate, people drank, people got married. I would imagine that most people eat every... How many guys have already eaten today? Yeah, that's a normal day. How many guys have drank something today? Everyone drinks. We get thirsty. Do you assume someone will get married today? I would assume someone's getting married somewhere in the world. So Jesus says it was just like a normal day. And all of a sudden, there's this huge epic flood that washed away all the unrighteous and wicked and evil people. And the people that were left behind, Noah and his family. And Jesus says that's what it will be like when he returns. It won't be a day of fanfare. It'll just be a common, normal day. And all of a sudden, Jesus shows up. I will say, one of the things I struggle with the 7 years of tribulation idea is that things will be like super catastrophic, and it'll be so bad that you'll have a pretty good idea that Jesus will return. Man, things are so bad, Jesus has to return. Well, that's not what Jesus says here. Jesus says, actually, on the day I show up, you're probably not going to be like, oh, this is the day. It's just going to be a normal day. And so he says, he'll come on a day that no one's thinking, and it'll be a day when Jesus shows up like a thief in the night. Now, the question is, why in the world does Jesus show up in secrecy? I mean, for example, I don't know if your family's this way, but whenever I say, hey, I'm coming to your house, I'll get a text. Hey, what time are you leaving? Well, I'm probably going to leave at this time. Well, did you leave at that time, or were you running late? We were running late. Well, what time do you think you'll get here? I don't know. How fast are you going right now? I don't know. Maybe 4 over the speed limit. What's the wind speed velocity that you're facing? I don't know. What's the barometric pressure? So that we know, they like a pretty good idea of when we show up. Because most people don't like to be surprised. We like to have a good idea. So why is it that Jesus says, I'm going to show up on a day that no one expects me. It'll seem like a normal day, and I'll just be there. He says, I'll be like a thief. And we know with thieves typically don't announce when they're going to break into your house. When Shelly and I first got married, someone broke into our car. They stole our aspirin. But then they dumped it all out. So I was like, why would you? But anyway, they didn't call us ahead of time and say, hey, we're going to break into your car tonight. You might want to have a shotgun ready. You might want to have some mace, whether the spray mace or the old maces that you swing with the balls on the, either way. Because we know that if a thief were to say, hey, I'm going to break in your house, they made a movie about that. It's called Home Alone. You're probably going to watch it in the next couple weeks. That's what happens when someone knows a thief is going to break in. So Jesus says in the same way, he's going to be like a thief that just shows up when no one expects him and come. Maybe we could ask this. How many of you guys, I think I've asked this before, but it's always good to make sure you guys are being truthful. How many of you guys, when you see a police officer, you magically become the best driver in the world? How many of you guys are that? David's shaking his head. We all become that. Even if you're a good, I would like to say I'm a fairly safe driver. I do try to go either the speed limit a little bit less, maybe a little bit more. But anyway, I try to drive the speed limit most of the time. But even then, When I see a police officer, the natural instinct is to tap the brake. Even if I was going under the speed, because we get nervous. Or we might magically put both hands on the wheel instead of using our knee. We put down the donut. We put down the sandwich. Whatever. And we become super conscientious. Now, the police do not want you to only drive conscientiously when you see them. They want you to drive that way all the time. But for some reason, we don't. And we have to be reminded you need to. It's the same way with Jesus. If Jesus were to say, I'm going to show up February 14th, 2022, what would you assume most people would do the last 5 minutes before that time showed up? Most people are probably going to go to church. They're probably going to say, okay, we've done whatever we want. Now it's time to get ready. Jesus doesn't want us to convert just for the sake of getting out of hell. Jesus truly wants us to be transformed people. And he doesn't want us to have these conversions at the last minute. He wants us to say, Jesus, transform me radically. And so that's why he doesn't tell us, because he wants us to live in a state of transformation all the time. So whether someone said, hey, Jesus is coming back this evening, or he's coming back in 100 years, our answer should be, well, it doesn't matter when he returns, because I'm living how he has called me to live right now. So then Jesus tells us a story. He tells us a story of a servant that the master leaves in charge. So the master is going away on vacation. He doesn't tell the servant when I'm coming back. All he says is, hey, while I'm gone, servant, you're now going to become the head of the whole house. And you're going to make sure that all the servants are fed at the proper time. And so the guy goes, and the servant says he could come back at any time. Sometimes vacations are cut short. And so the servant says, instead of assuming he might be gone, let's just do what he said to do at all times. And when he returns, he'll see that I'm doing exactly what he wants to do. So the master shows up. The servant's feeding everyone like he's supposed to. And the master says, good job. Since you've watched over your fellow servants and you cared for them, which is interesting that by the master says, in order for you to be in charge of everything, you have to serve everybody. That's interesting to me. There's almost something in the Beatitudes about if you humble yourself. Anyway, we'll talk more about that later. But the master says, because you have served everyone and you're doing exactly what I called you to do, I'm going to promote you. And now you're in charge of everything I own, not just the servants. Good story. Then Jesus tells another story. This is kind of the opposite. And he says, now imagine, same scenario, the master is going on a long trip and he puts one servant in charge of all the servants and then he leaves. That servant in this scenario doesn't say, well, I should probably be doing what I've been told to do. This servant says, you know what? He's going to be gone for a while. I'm just going to do whatever I want. And so he takes all the food that was meant for the servants. He invites all of his friends over. And they all get drunk, and they begin to eat the food that the servants were supposed to eat, and the servants are starving. Then the head servant, instead of caring for the other ones, he begins to beat them and harass them and treat them poorly. And Jesus says, in this scenario, the servant or the master shows up, he sees that the servant has not been doing what he wants. And instead of being a time of promotion, this is a time of horror. And I forget what my clever word, but it's a time of horror and punishment. Notice what the master says. He says in verse 51, he says, cut the servant into pieces. Now, he probably doesn't literally mean that, because if you look at the next line, he says, cut him into a bunch of pieces, but then put him with the hypocrites. You can't really chop somebody up and then put them with other people. Which, I mean, don't think about that. That's gross. What it probably gets at is he needs to be punished severely. He needs to be punished in the same way that gets the same effect as cutting someone in pieces. It's a very harsh punishment. And then he says, after you punish him this way, put him with the hypocrites. Now, you and I would say that a hypocrite is someone who says one thing and does the other. So I might say, for example, I'm the best basketball player you've ever seen. Now, if you know me, you would laugh, because I'm actually not very good at basketball whatsoever. I would be a hypocrite. The Greek word for hypocrite is actually hypokrates. It's almost word spelled almost the same. Say that with me. Let's be a little interactive. Say hypokrates. Hypokrates. And hypokrates is the Greek word for stage actor. The Rock would be a hypokrates. Or Chris Evans would be a hypokrates. they're stage actors. They're people that perform, they act, and pretend to be someone else. And so when the Bible writers use that word, whenever someone acts one way, that's not truthful. It's, I'm giving a performance. And so the master says that this servant is a hypocrites, because when the master's there, he acts like, hey, you can put me in charge of everything. I'm good. I can care for things how you want them cared for. But when the master leaves, that mask comes off and the reality is there. I don't treat people very well whatsoever. And so the master says, cut him in pieces, put him with the other actors, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And we might say that typically when we think of weeping, we usually think of someone that is crying. They're sad. Oh man, this poor guy, if only he knew, and now he's got to live in the punishment. That's actually, the idea of weeping and gnashing of teeth gets at someone is so angry. Have you ever been so mad at someone that it made you cry? Like, you weren't sad. You're not sad at all. You're just so angry. And you just clench your teeth like Charlton Heston, who always talks like this. That's what weeping. It's not I'm sad because something is happening to me. I wish I could go back in time and change it. This is the weeping and gnashing of teeth of someone who knows they've done wrong, but they're angry that they're being held accountable for it. How dare you? For example, and I think I've shared this before. When I worked at Walmart, I was a cashier, and there was another cashier named Curtis. And one day, at Walmart, you're supposed to, I don't know if they do it this way where you work, Randy, you can let me know later. We were supposed to, if you don't have customers in your line, you go stand at the edge of your register and try to hail customers in. It's called redlining, because there was a red line that went through. Anyway, so I'm standing there, and I notice that Curtis is hunkered down behind his register with an Etch-a-Sketch, playing with it. One of the managers comes by, very politely, hey, Curtis, I need you to get back to work. He didn't yell. He didn't raise his voice. He didn't draw any attention to Curtis. Hey, Curtis, I need you to get back to work. Curtis comes up, slams the Etch-a-Sketch down, and says, I hate working at this place. These people, all they do is yell at you. All they do is tell you to work. I was like, oh, my goodness, that's what we're paying you to do. And I was like, he didn't yell at you. He just very politely said, hey, Curtis, I need you to get back to work. That day, Curtis was weeping and gnashing his teeth. He was angry. Was he angry that he did something wrong? No, he was angry that he got in trouble for doing what he wanted to do. How dare you do? That's what weeping and gnashing of, it's not a set, if only I had one chance to repent, I would change. No, it's not. It's this idea of, God, how dare you tell me I can't do what I'm doing? It's an anger at God for God being holy and asking us to live. I always call this to live. And so the servant is cut in pieces or severely punished. He's put with the other people who act one way but live another way, where there's anger at being held accountable. This parable and the next three parables we're going to look at over the next week are going to deal with how we live as Christians. And it raises a question. Does this mean, and do these next parables mean, that we are saved by our works? That when Jesus shows up, he's going to look at your life and say, have you done X, Y, and Z, A, B, and C? If not, toodaloo. If so, come on in. Is Jesus saying in the story that we earn our salvation by doing what we're called to do? And at the very least, it poses a problem that we have to stop and think about. Because Paul would say that we are not saved by works. We are saved by grace through faith. We put our faith in what Jesus has done on the cross. We don't earn it. In fact, Jesus says in John 3 that all we have to do in salvation is we look to Jesus. And he says it's like in the Old Testament when Moses had that bronze serpent and he lifts it up. And all you have to do to be saved from the poison is you just look. Oh, I looked at it. I'm saved now. That's all you have to do. And Jesus says in the same way, God the Father will lift me up and anyone who looks to me will be saved. That's nothing we've done. We just trust in Jesus for our salvation. So when Jesus goes through these parables about the goats who don't do what he's called to do, the 10 foolish bridesmaids, the servant who doesn't do what the master has asked him to do, is Jesus saying, forget that saved by grace stuff. You're saved by what you do. That raises a good question, because we could say, well, it doesn't matter what you do. Well, that doesn't appear to be what Jesus is saying in Matthew 24. But I also don't think he's saying that we're saved by doing a bunch of good deeds. So what do we do? Because I think we're in a conundrum now. Maybe what we should do is maybe we look at all of what Jesus is calling, or we look at everything that Jesus is doing in the Gospels. Because we have a tendency, and I think all people through all church history have a tendency to make things as simple as possible to the detriment of truth. What has Jesus come to do? Jesus has just come to die for your sins and get you into heaven. You don't really see that describing Christianity in the Gospels. When Jesus shows up, I mean, even before he shows up, his cousin John the Baptist is preaching this very simple sermon, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." Then Jesus shows up and begins to implement the kingdom of heaven. He goes into these areas of brokenness and poverty and sickness and demon possession, and he begins to cleanse those areas. If people are demon possessed, he pushes the demons out. If people are sick, he pushes the sickness out. If people are oppressed, he goes in there and sets them free. Jesus is creating in this pocket of this kingdom of men, he is creating these small pockets of the kingdom of God everywhere he goes. And he's establishing that in the kingdom of God, things don't run the same as they do in the kingdom of men. And he begins to go through, he begins to preach to the religious leaders, and he says, "You guys are corrupt. You have no place in the kingdom of God." He goes to the political leaders and says, "You're corrupt. And this kind of corruption has no place in the kingdom of God." And he begins to minister to people and heal people. And he begins to say things like this: "For those who humble themselves before God and begin to serve other people, that's what the kingdom of God looks like. There is place for you." And he says things like this: that those who are humble in spirit and they submit themselves to everyone and they give up everything for God, the reality is those who give up everything for God are rewarded with, what is it? "Blessed are those who are humble in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." They receive God's kingdom. Those who hunger and thirst after God, they receive God. Those who give all their strength to God and are meek, they receive God. They receive God's inheritance. So it's this upside down kingdom of how things work, that how the kingdom of men is defined by savagery and violence and hate and evil. There's no place for that in God's kingdom. And those who humble themselves and serve others and love other people, they're elevated because that is exactly what the kingdom of God looks like. What Jesus is getting at the very end of his ministry is he's trying to help us understand that the kingdom of God isn't saying some magical prayer at the altar to get saved. The kingdom of God is a complete transformation of the whole world, and God trying to draw as many people into that kingdom as absolutely possible. So you guys are familiar with 2 Corinthians 5:17. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ," finish it for him, "he is a new creation." But it's interesting, in Greek it doesn't say that. In Greek it says this: "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, new creation." It doesn't specifically say he, it just says new creation. Paul's understanding is that Jesus is working to transform the whole world into his kingdom. And as we embrace Jesus, we step into that. We become part of that new creation. This isn't just Jesus saving a handful of people here and there. This is Jesus transforming everything, the very reality itself, and inviting as many people into that transformation as possible. And so as Jesus saves us, he begins this transforming work in our lives to transform us into citizens of the kingdom of God. One time we did this little cute experiment. We're not going to do it today because you'll be like, "We did this already." But I asked you guys to get in partners and make a list of things that if you were to go to a new country and you wanted to become a citizen of that country, what would you have to do? And you guys said things like this: you would have to learn the language, you would have to learn the rules, you would have to learn their laws, their history, their culture, their heritage, you would have to learn how to drive, you'd have to learn all these things. It's the same way when we become citizens of the kingdom of God. We have to learn new language. We don't use hate language anymore. We now use the language of Jesus. We use language that is truthful, that is loving, that is kind. We use language that teaches. We use language that admonishes people. How do we act? Well, we act like Jesus does. We live in a way that serves and lifts other people up, and then we live in a way that honors God with everything we do. How do we think? Well, we don't think like the world anymore. We now think with a transformed imagination that puts Jesus at the center of all of our life, and everything revolves around him. This new kingdom of God lifestyle that we're called to is a complete transformation of our character. It's not just Jesus, thanks for dying so I can go to heaven when I die. It is, Jesus, thank you for redeeming the whole world and working in my life to transform me. So when we come to this parable and the next several parables, these aren't stories of people who tried as hard as they could and they didn't do enough good deeds. You know, I read this the other day. This is not 60% of unsaved. This is 60% of Christians. 60% of Christians believe that they are saved by doing more good deeds than bad deeds. You know what that is? That's wrong. That's not salvation. That's not what this is. If this foolish servant would have just fed two more people, he would have made it. Oh, that poor guy. He tried his heart. These aren't people who are trying to do more good than bad. These are people who are called to be transformed, and they refuse to be transformed. That's what we're dealing with. Christians who want the benefits of salvation, but there's no true following of Jesus. That instead of saying, okay, you've called me to be saved, I'm going to follow you and allow you to completely save me and transform me. It's just, nope, you've given me what I wanted. Thanks, Jesus. Farewell. We need to be careful that we don't turn salvation into this get-out-of-hell-free monopoly card. That salvation is a complete call for the transformation of us as God's people. That's why I think it's very interesting that in verse 51 he calls this guy a stage actor. That you have a role that you're playing, but it's not the reality of who you are. You might seem like a Christian, but in the very depths of who you are, that's not who you are behind the mask. As my youth pastor would say, just because you go to McDonald's, that doesn't make you a cheeseburger. Just because you say the word Christian doesn't mean that you are. God's people are called to step into this kingdom of God, this transforming kingdom, where Jesus transforms our thoughts, our words, our actions, even how we spend and where we go. That's what Jesus is calling us to. That's what the kingdom of God is, a kingdom of transformed people. And for a person to say, I'm going to actively resist the transforming work of Jesus, but I still want to go to heaven when I die, Jesus would say, that's not how this works. Let's go real quick to Matthew 7. This is a very interesting passage. Matthew 7:21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Oh no, I call Jesus Lord. Maybe he's talking to me. Let's keep going though. But only he who does the will of my Father who's in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, and this is interesting, Jesus says the only people who can go into the kingdom of heaven are those who do God's will. Notice what the response to that is. Oh, okay, well, notice this, Jesus. Didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we drive out demons? Didn't we perform miracles? We did the Father's will. And Jesus says, well, not quite. Then I tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. You guys still kept living this untransformed life. All you did was add good deeds to it, but that's still an untransformed life. The kingdom of God's not a place of untransformed people. The kingdom of God is a place of transformed people who say, Jesus, transform me and make me like you. Does that mean that we'll always do everything correct? We're probably going to make mistakes. But our goal is, Jesus, transform me. We're not being people that actively resist the transformation of the kingdom of God. So this Advent season, as we live our lives, as we prepare for Jesus' return, we simply ask ourselves, am I living in a way that reflects Jesus is transforming me? Remember when we went through the series on marriage, and I said, here's a good way to find out if you're a good husband. Just ask your wife. Remember when I said that, and some of you chuckled, and some of you who are wives gave the death glare to your husband, and I was like, oh no. And then the next week we brought it up, and I said, now, wives, if you want to find out you're a good wife, ask your husband. Maybe it's as simple as saying, if you want to find out if you're a transformed person, just ask somebody. That's scary, isn't it? Shelby, when you go to work this week, just randomly say, hey, I follow Jesus. Do my words reflect that? Do you guys know that I'm a Christian by how I speak? That's a scary thing to say. Or Randy, when you go to Walmart, what a beautiful place to show Jesus to people. When you go to Walmart, just casually, hey guys, I'm just curious. Do I work like I reflect Jesus? Those are easy questions to say at church, aren't they? They're hard questions. Or ask your spouse, ask your kids, ask your parents, hey, Do I reflect Jesus in how I speak and how I act? And if the answer is no, those are some good questions to ask Jesus. Jesus, will you work in my life to show that I'm transformed? Are we saved by doing enough good deeds? No, we are not. That would be a heresy. Does it matter what we do or what we don't do? That would also be a false statement. Jesus has come to establish his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven, and he calls us to be transformed people and to actively resist that transformation. That's where Jesus says that's the problem. If you actively resist being transformed into the image of Jesus, it's kind of like, we'll talk about Chuck E. Cheese. I don't even know if that, someone told me this week they still exist. I do not like Chuck E. Cheese. I do not like going in a place that sells cardboard with pizza toppings on it. CEO of Chuck E. Cheese, if you're listening, I'm sorry. I'll even look at the camera. I apologize immensely. I just don't like your place. Anyway, there's all these kids running and screaming. Everything's sticky. The noise is loud, and there's these creepy mice people. Like, you guys know I don't like mice to begin with. But this giant rat that follows you around smiling and staring at you with deep, soulless eyes, that's horrific. That being said, if you were to say, Jeff, do you want to go to Chuck E. Cheese today? I would say no. Why? Because everything about that place is the opposite of what I want. So if I were to say yes, and we get there and it's like, Shelby, I can't believe you brought me to Chuck E. Cheese. I can't believe you're... And you say, Jeff, I'm confused. Because didn't you know that Chuck E. Cheese has like a 7-foot giant rat that chases you down and wants to hug you? Yes. Jeff, didn't you know they serve this kind of pizza? Yes. Didn't you know that everything's super sticky there? Yes. Then Jeff, I'm confused why you want to be here. And that's how it is with the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a place of transformation, a place of love, a place of peace and joy and all the goodness of God. And to actively resist that and say, that's not what I want in my life now. Well, what do you expect to happen when you die and you're taken there? And if you don't want it here, what are you going to do when you're confronted with the totality of the kingdom of God? As we prepare our hearts today, maybe a good question would be, Jesus, how do I understand what salvation is? Is salvation a cute little card that says, get out of hell when you die? Is salvation, I hope I did enough good deeds. God, I hope I did at least one better good deed than bad. Is salvation, Jesus, I'm just going to do whatever I want. Or does Jesus say that salvation is the transformation of all things and the redemption of all things and drawing as many people into that transformation as possible? That seems to be what Jesus is getting at in the Gospels. This idea of spreading the kingdom of heaven all over the earth so that as it is in heaven, it's on earth. So with that, I'm going to invite Tina to come back up. We're going to close with, we're going to sing O Come, O Come, Emmanuel one more time for our closing hymn. And as we sing this final song, I would encourage you, just spend some time in prayer as we sing and ask the Lord, what's going on in your heart? How do you define salvation? Is salvation just, I need to do this before I die so I don't go to hell? Or is salvation, Jesus, you are actively working to transform the world. Transform me too. So with that, Tina, will you lead us? And then we'll close in prayer.
All right, stand with me, please.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appears. come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations bind all peoples in one heart and mind. Bid envy, strife, and quarrel cease. Fill the whole world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou dear spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows pull her to flight.